In this video, I'm going to talk about Vedic astrology and human design. Several of my students asked me to give a talk on this after I mentioned human design in the context of one particular astrology course I taught a few months ago. So I thought I would just give a couple ideas about human design along with Vedic astrology for those of you all who are studying both. Okay. Now, first of all, how I see it is that I don't really consider human design different from Vedic astrology, different from Persian astrology, different than Western astrology. I really see it all as Jyotish, which is the science of astronomy. Everything up there in the heavens, the rotations of the planets, including the rotation of the Earth, which creates the houses, is relevant to our experience, our lives on Earth. It's all just astrology. It's all astronomy applied to human understanding. So I don't really think that, oh, we need to do Vedic astrology only or Western astrology only, because I think that different cultures held on to certain techniques that work in the context of their culture. Right now we have a very different culture. For this reason, we have to apply astrology in the context of this culture. And this culture is much more complex than the cultures we've had in the past couple thousand years from which we get all of our astrology techniques, from whatever culture we've pulled them in. Human design is an exception in that this is a system of astrology that we were not aware of until the latter part of the 20th century. So it really is a astrology system that is very relevant to our modern lives. So with all these different systems and things we can do, it's really about what do you want to do? What works good to do it? And I find that different things work better for different things, and we should learn what we need to learn to use. Okay. Now, one of the other important things about astrology, one of the most fascinating things to me, is the different layers we have. Okay. We have so many layers going on. So like, we say, oh, Venus, and we've got Venus doing something, okay? And of course, Venus is the planet of relationships. Venus is the planet of getting our nourishment from the world, okay? There's so many levels to fulfilling that. Okay, let's take relationships for instance. We can look at Western inter-aspects, which will show a kind of theme between Venuses, between two people, okay? Then we can look at the nakshatras using Vedic astrology and see how those Venuses like each other with Vedic astrology, okay? And then we can look at what's going on relationship-wise between two people with the composite chart, with human design connections. So there's so many different layers going on, and each of these things is a different layer, okay? So we might look at one layer and say, oh, everything's great. But imagine it like a cake, you know, and there's all this good stuff, and you're talking about one particular layer that's really yummy. But to get to that layer, maybe they have to get to this really crusty, nasty layer of the cake first. Or maybe the first layer is really nice, but underneath that is a layer that's really kind of indigestible. So I think the main reason us astrologers make mistakes is because we're not looking at the complete cake. We're looking at one layer. So when you just do Western inter-aspects for your compatibility, or you just look if what planets are aspecting each other with Vedic astrology for compatibility, it's just one layer. There's other layers going on. And really one of the most fascinating layers I find is the layer called human design. Now with human design, what basically we do is we plot the planets against the I Ching. So the zodiac, instead of being divided into 12 signs and 108 navamshas and so on, the zodiac is divided into 64 hexagrams, the hexagrams of the I Ching. And the planets are actually operating through the expression of that I Ching hexagram. So if you're a person who studied the I Ching, you're going to be able to jump right onto the human design bandwagon and just run with it, because basically it's I Ching astrology. Okay? So we divide the zodiac into 64 parts. And each of those parts is divided into six parts, which is a line. So now how in the I Ching, we have a hexagram, which has six lines into it. That's why we call it a hexagram. Hex means six, as in hexagonal. And each of those lines is a position in the zodiac. And there's further subdivisions possible, but that's your basic subdivision. 64 hexagrams divided into six lines each, which gives well over 360 permutations. So we're looking at little parts of the zodiac that are less than a degree in size. Okay? So by plotting our planets against the I Ching, we see a particular layer. A layer of 1 divided by 64. Then we can take our nakshatras and we can divide the zodiac into 27 nakshatras. And now we're getting another layer. And then we can take the Rashis and divide them by 12 and get another layer. And Rashis are so fascinating because we can take those 12 signs and divide them into 60 Shashti Amshas and get 12 by 60 divisions, okay? So there's all these ways we're breaking down the chart into different layers. But what I love about the zodiac itself is that we can take the 12 signs, break it into the Hora, which is two more layers and equals 24, or the Drakana 36, and we keep doing that up into the 60th Varga, where we're going way, way deep into very, very small layers, layers that are half a degree in size, okay? And working with that half degree layer is really important at times. So we're working with basically layers. Even when we look at just the birth chart and we look at the signs of the zodiac, that's like the very basic layer. We use the Navamsha, we're using a much more, much deeper layer. And as a lot of Vedic astrologers know, always examine the Navamsha as like a rule, okay, as a principle. Because if we just look at the Rashi layer but we skip that layer, we might make some mistakes, okay? So when we start looking at human design, how I see it, we're looking at another layer, all right? Now the beauty of this layer is it really has to do with the energy of the person. Think of this, we all have this energetic body, this aura body. And what is energy? Energy is potential. That's all energy is. It's potential. So think of where your energy in your body is rooted, in your root center. That root center energy is sleeping, it's slumbering. It's like the nuclear bomb in a little bit of matter, okay? Every bit of matter has this tremendous energy potential. But it's not like everything on Earth is blowing up around us, right? Same within us, same in our energy system. There's this potential, this energy potential in our root. And that energy potential flows through us and gives our energy potential. And that's essentially what human design is. We're looking at our energy potential. Now the thing about it is, it's our energy potential. I really have to stress the key word, potential, potential, potential. What are you going to do with that energy potential? Okay? Potential and doing are completely different things. And I find what happens is, if we just look at that energy potential and we automatically expect people to do it, we're going to be wrong lots of times. We'll see that people aren't living their energy potential. In fact, the Ra, the founder of human design, had a word for this, and he called it not-self. He said, everyone's living as the not-self, meaning they're not really living as the energy being they are and expressing that energy potential. They're running around like crazy people trying to do everything but that, to the point that even their energy potential is being used in a deranged fashion and causing different diseases. Okay? So we want to keep in mind with human design, it's our energy potential. And there's so many things that are helping that potential unlock, and there's so many things that are bottling that potential down. Okay? Now, with Vedic astrology, we can kind of see what's happening with that potential. Is this person living that potential? Where is that potential stuck? Why is it stuck? Psychologically, why is it stuck? You know, we can get all this additional information about that potential. Okay, my two favorite tools from Vedic astrology that I like to use in reference to that energy potential indicated by the human design chart are the maturation ages of the planet and the Lajitati Avashtas, as always. Those are always my two favorite techniques. I mean, those things, if you learn two things in astrology, learn those two. Okay, and then of course learn Rahu and Ketu as well. So with this energy potential, if you looked at a human design chart, and again, most of you all watching this video know that, you have a chart with 9 centers. And those centers are colored in, which means they're defined, or they're empty, which means they're undefined. The defined centers are more constants in our life, things that we have a regularity with, where we know what to expect, we have a comfort zone with them. We have security. Then we have our empty centers, where we have no sense of security, and which we instead have freedom. It's a very simple thing. There's a formula. More security, less freedom. Greater freedom, less security. Those are the scales of life. Okay? It's everything you look at. If you look at your life, where you're secure, you've given up freedom. Where you're free, you have no security. Okay? So the empty centers are where we are free. But the ego doesn't like that feeling of insecurity. And so if the person has issues, psychological issues, they really, really try to define that area of freedom. They try to make that area of freedom secure. And Ra, the founder of human design, calls this not selfing a center. Okay? Now, the reason we do that is because we have some wound, some pain, as indicated by the Lajitadya Vashtas in our chart. That makes us not be able to live freely. It's the nature of our souls to live free. And it's the nature of our being to have an element of security to stand on. Okay? But the hurt parts of ourself are always clinging and desperately seeking more of something. They don't even know what. They just want more, more, more of something. Okay? And in the pursuit of that, those hurt parts of ourselves cause lots of problems. Now, those hurt parts of ourselves are causing all those problems, attempting to find a real meaningful security, something they can count on. But it never works. That's the problem with it. Okay? It's like a good guy who's trying to save the world, but everything he does doesn't work. That's what our wounds are like. The wounds want to protect us, want to save us, want to keep us from pain. They go about it in ways that guarantee we suffer. Okay? And when that happens, instead of living out our energy potential, we end up doing what's called not selfing. Okay? And those people who've studied human design, you know, the whole idea of it is learning to live as yourself, don't live as your not-self. That's the whole theory, the whole, let's say, principle behind it, the whole goal. All right? And people who've tried that know how hard it is to live as yourselves, you know? How you just catch yourself living in transference, which means basically living upside down, okay? And how you end up, trying to prove things, trying to make centers work for you that are you're meant to experience freedom in, okay? And again, the reason we do that, look to the Lajitadya Vashtas. Those are indicating the psychological wounds, the pains that are pushing us out of the self into the not-self. Okay? So you can imagine the potential of this. Let's say you see a gate, and there's a planet in that gate that's in a bad Lajitadya Vashta. Then you know that's the gateway for them to be not-selfing. And by working with the person to heal the Lajitadya Vashta, they'll automatically go back into living as themselves. So the current course I'm doing on Lajitadya Vashtas, where this actually came up, was that it's all about the habits that our psychology is created within us cause us to get lost in our lives. Where instead of doing the right thing, we're doing a habitual thing. And by starting to break free from those habits, we get the option of doing the right thing, which is doing the thing indicated by our true self, by our true energy potential. Okay? And it's a really helpful way to get out of not selfing by understanding the very mechanism, the habit through which we're breaking, that we are not selfing. The hard thing about living as oneself is that we're in the habit of not selfing. And again, that's a human design context of basically means not living as in a way that's not truly you. So by learning the Lajitadya Vashtas that indicate the habits with that we're doing, the habits that we're doing that take us away from being our true self, we can get back into the not self, or excuse me, into being the true self, get away from the not self. So the Lajitata Vashta is one of my favorite tools in conjunction with human design to see why isn't the person living out their energy potential, their human design, aka why are they not selfing, and more importantly, what habit do they have to change in order to stop not selfing and live as their true selves? Well, obviously they need to stop the habit of not selfing. Okay, that's great. But that can be such a vague feeling. What about the actual details? What about the details of, oh, every time you feel pressure, you succumb. So you need to learn to fight for your right to be. You're in the habit of not fighting for your right to be. And you need to realize that sometimes we have to fight for our right to be. And you need to get in the habit of fighting for your right to be. Because some people are just not in the habit of fighting for their right to be. So in the minute some person comes along and says no, they're not going to do it. Instead, maybe they're waiting for permission. They're in the habit of waiting for permission. Say I can do this, say I can do that. Instead of saying I have the right to live as myself and therefore I'm going to do it. And even if that creates a fight, I'm going to do it. I'm going to fight for my right to be. Some people are not in the habit. Other people are in a super habit of fighting for their right to be. And they have an element of freedom on that level to live as their true selves. But maybe they're stuck on something else. Okay? Can't get into all of that because that's like literally a 100-hour course by the time we cover all the nuances and possibilities of the different Vajitadya Vashtas and how they trap us into the not-self. Okay? And until we heal that Lajitadya Vashta, until we get out of the habit of living as our not-self and into the habit of living as ourselves as a result, we can't use that energy potential. The energy potential is going to get disrupted and distorted and ultimately result in mental, emotional, and physical illness. Okay? Mental illness is having wrong ideas about our lives and ourselves. Emotional illness is, of course, longings, depressions, unfulfillable emotional needs, unrealistic emotional needs, those kinds of things. And physical illness, of course, your body starts breaking down. So that's what happens when your energy potential gets skewed. All right? Ra on human design has a lot of stuff about talking what kind of health problems people might experience as a result of different centers not operating correctly. Okay? Why don't they operate correctly? Because we're hijacking that energy potential and distorting it through our negative Lajitadya Vashtas. Okay? The other thing that I love to use with human design is the planetary maturation, the maturation age. Jupiter matures at 16. That's our first planet to mature. Sun at 21, Moon at 23, Venus at 24, Mars at 28, Mercury at 32, Saturn at 36, Rahu at 42, Ketu at 48. So let's say you have a channel and you're 30 years old and you got this beautiful channel and you don't see that channel working in your life. It's like, I don't have this channel, you know? And again, a channel in human design is when two I Chings link up to create a really powerful flow of energy that you can use throughout your life, but you're not going to really be able to use it fully until the planet that's in that channel matures. Because until a planet matures, we're using it to way less than our potential. So until a planet matures, we can't use the energy potential indicated by that human design placement. Okay. Once the planet matures, we can use it to that energy potential. Before that, we're only using it to a fraction of that energy potential. For instance, Mars is one strength. Best bike racers are 28, the year Mars matures. That's when they finally can use their full potential to win races. Okay. Now, after that, they start to age, and you know, due to aging, their potential starts to diminish very, very, very slowly. Up until 28, their potential escalates very rapidly. And at 28, it peaks. Okay? So, it's not that they can't win a lot of great races at 21, 22. A lot of people become world champions at 23, won the Tour de France at 23, and so on. But they're still moving up in their energy potential. Okay? Now, of course, mishaps can destroy all that. but they still have time to develop their energy potential. With the human design chart, it's the same thing. You won't use the full potential of a channel until the planet that's in the channel matures. Okay? So if you're trying to work a channel and you're going, it's not working really good, and it's Saturn's in it, and you're 30 and you haven't hit 36, you haven't experienced your potential in that channel yet. Okay? So you know that's a, isn't that a wonderful thing to know, that you can build on your potential? At 36, all a person's potential is mature with respect to what they can do. But we still don't know what we're here for until we get into the road of our destiny. And that is indicated by Rahu and Ketu, the nodes of the moon. Rahu is the north node, Ketu is the south node. Alright? Now, at 42, Rahu matures. Which means at 42, we actually start becoming aware of our destiny and the road we have to travel in order to grow and really grow into ourselves. Okay, we all have this quest we have to go on to, this ride of our lives, let's say. And that's indicated by Rahu. So once all the other planets get mature at 36, and we're given 6 years to get used to, okay, my new potential, and then we have to start walking that path to some degree, you know, slowly or quickly, depending on what's going on in your life, at 42, we're really ready to walk that path fully for the first time. And that's not to say that path is not going to be burdensome. It's going to be extremely burdensome. It never gets easy. It's Rahu, the north node, which is considered a very difficult planet that brings lots of sudden, or not sudden, but very unexpectedly hard things that we couldn't imagine. Okay. Now, Ra talks about Rahu and Ketu, the north and south nodes of the moon, in the context of the environment. And the environment that we need to be in order to make the growth into the person we are, is indicated by the nodal axis in the human design chart. And in Vedic astrology, at 42, Rahu matures. At 48, Ketu matures. So this is the time that we can really start embracing that environment fully. Again, we're always aware of that environment, but until that Rahu maturation, we're not really ready to embrace that environment fully. It's a rare person that does. Okay? Why? Because Rahu matures so late. And of course, if you have a channel with the north node Rahu or the south node Ketu, realize that the potential of that channel isn't going to be full until your Rahu or Ketu matures at 42 or 48, as the case may be. Okay, so among the last channels we really can start to use to their full potential is going to be the channel formed by Rahu and Ketu. Also, if you're looking at like compatibility and you see you've got a connection with someone in a channel, and say you're 30 years old and the connection's made with Mercury, and Mercury matures at 32, you know that you can't take full advantage of that channel with that person yet. That you can grow into taking more advantage of that energy potential. And that because of that, you'll find over the next 2 years, that channel is providing more for you all. Okay? So basically, we kind of have this timing method with how our energy potential is unfolding by using the maturation ages of the planets. Okay? And then we can use these avashtas to see, you know, the more psychological detail of why we're not selfing, okay? And through that, getting, you know, to understand the habit we've created that causes us to step into the not-self over and over again. And then we can get into the habit of not following that bad habit. We can get into a good habit of selfing, okay? So those are, I think, two of the more powerful things we can use with human design. It's also fun lots of times to, like say you've got Jupiter ruling a particular house and in your chart, and you've got this channel with Jupiter, or you've got some kind of connection with the person with your Jupiter, your human design chart, then you know that, okay, this house is going to come along for the ride. So you can use the house lordships. Houses are not something that Ra ever used in the human design chart, but you can, and it works really, really well. One thing I noticed that kind of started this whole subject, I was talking about the Lajitadi Avashta of Saturn starving the moon. Okay, that's when Saturn joins the moon, then the moon gets starved by Saturn. And the moon is the planet in astrology that allows us to respond. As Ross says, we need to respond to life. It's the moon that helps us respond to life correctly. The moon in Vedic astrology is the planet that's full of knowing. Okay? It's full of our inner knowing. And it's the receptive planet that lets us wait for life and then have a response to it that we can feel as our aha or whatever our authority is indicating. Okay? Now, and in human design, the authority is the way our inner voice is trying to communicate to our what we should, our yeses and nos. Should I do this? Yes or no? Should I do that? Yes or no? Okay? So the moon is such an important thing for that. And when the moon is starred by Saturn, it becomes really, really hard to live in response. Like, extremely hard. Look for people who got moon and Saturn in the same zodiac signs. And you see how they struggle with responding, okay? And how they're so often to always pick the thing that causes everything to go wrong in their lives, right? Well, if you're a manifester, the Saturn-Moon conjunction doesn't seem to be as big of a deal. So when I see a person's a manifester with the Saturn-Moon conjunction, I know that's not going to hold them up in life as much as it will for any of the other types. The reason is because manifestors are the one type that don't work in response. Manifestors are the type that say, I want to do this, I'm going to walk this road. They have the ability to act upon their wishes, let's say, upon their plan, more so than do any of the other human design types. So if they are lacking response with the Saturn-Moon conjunction, they'll do fine. So if I see like a family of four people and they all have Saturn-Moon conjunctions, I know the one who's the manifester had the more successful, easy life and ran, you know, had less problems in their life than the ones who didn't have, who weren't manifestors, okay? So just like this interesting thing, as you learn Vedic astrology, or if you know it, you start like saying, okay, when I do human design, I want to remember that I know astrology, you know, typical zodiacal astrology, you can start putting together a lot of really simple things. But the, you know, the Lajitadya Vashtas and the, what's it called, the maturation ages, I find to be especially really useful for working with human design. So I really see human design as this very deep layer of energy potential. It really seems to me like maybe the deepest layer of astrology that we're dealing with, you know, which is this energy potential. This energy has the potential to go in certain ways. And it's very limited in how it can go. Ultimately, everything's about energy potential or energy flow. Let's say we got Saturn aspecting Venus. Energetically, that means something, like Saturn aspecting Venus in the chart. Well, we know from Vedic astrology that Saturn can affect Venus very strongly by being in conjunction, by you know, Venus being three houses in front, by Venus being 10 houses from it, or by Venus being in seven houses from it. So there's four ways that Saturn can make a really powerful aspect to Venus. Okay? So there's a lot of possibilities. With Western astrology, you've got squares and sextiles and oppositions and trines are classical aspects and conjunctions. And then in modern Western astrology, they like to use inconjunctions and semi-sextiles if you want to throw those in. There's so many ways that planets can connect and strive to do something with Western aspects and Vedic aspects. And you add Rashi aspects of Jaimini, where you get every planet can influence four signs of the zodiac, the one it's in and the three that sign aspects. And all of a sudden you've got all these different things that are connecting, right? The interesting thing about human design is a planet in a particular place can only make one energy flow to one other place. There's one area of the human design chart where a planet in one particular hexagram, I Ching hexagram, or gate as it's called, can connect to, you know, a couple other planets in different positions. But normally it's one place only. One little hexagram that this planet, this hexagram can connect to. So it's showing a very, very limited amount of connections compared to other any other type of astrology, which normally have four possibilities of connection for every position, okay? even with nakshatras, there's actually nakshatra aspects. And between the conjunction of nakshatra and the aspects, it gives us four possibilities again. Okay? But human design is normally one. So we're looking at the very limited connections. So when there is a connection, it's very important. Okay? And that's why it's creating this channel of energy flow, of true energy potential. So I really see the human design chart as the energy potential. So let's say you look at a chart and there's always energy potential for all this cool stuff. And you look at their birth chart and you see that there's not a lot going on, or there's a lot of troubled avashtas, let's say. Then you know that energy potential is being very, very distorted and buried and not manifesting. Same in a compatibility. If you look at the human design and you see this great energy potential between two people, but they don't have any things going on in their astrology together, practically speaking, that potential can't flow. Okay? So again, it's another layer. And the vice versa exists as well. People can have lots of energy potential with lots of cool aspects, but if their human design is not making a lot of connections, when it comes to how deep they can connect with all these fingers that are touching each other, how deep they can feel with those little fingers, it comes back down to their energy potential. Okay? So it's like all these little conjunctions and aspects we have between planets with people. There could be 20, 30 little aspects and conjunctions between a chart. You know? These little things touching each other. It's kind of like each of these things is like a little socket plugging into the other person, a little electrical plug. But which one has the juice? Where's all the voltage, you know? If there's only 1 volt, 1 amp, big deal. If you got 120 volts and 15 amps, now you can light up a room, okay? So, very same thing is happening with astrology. If you got lots of nice little Western or Vedic astrology connections between two people, well, that means there's places that the wires are connected for this energy flow that's in their human design chart to really take off and really do something real in their world. Because when we look at the aspects with, you know, other types of astrology outside of human design, we're basically looking at concrete possibilities, not energetic possibilities, but concrete things. Yes, when I'm with this person, this happens. Okay, how powerfully does it happen? How deep does it go when that happens? You know, so you can go and be around someone every time you're around them, you're cracking jokes. But how deep of an impact does that person have on you after you leave and you're done cracking jokes, right? That determines by how much energy is going to flow, which comes down to your energy potential of your human design. So I find it really, really useful and fascinating to like always keep in mind this energy potential. And what's so great about it, you can look at a human design chart, and it's so simple when it comes to the energy potential. There might be one, maybe up to 7 connections that are really meaningful in the entire chart. Okay? Then you go over to your Western astrology, you've got 30. And you go to your composite chart and you got several. And your Western Vedic astrology, you've got a lot more. You're dealing with just dozens of possibilities. Okay? But you need to use both. Because all those possibilities will only be meaningful enough for those people if the energy potential is there. All those things that they can actually do in the real world, indicated by the Western and Vedic astrology aspects and so on, will only be meaningful if there's a deep energy connection, if there's the energy potential to really do something big with those things. And if there's the energy potential but nothing realistically to touch bases on with the Vedic and or Western aspects and compatibilities, then that energy potential can't flow anywhere, it has nowhere to flow. Okay? Now, I've really, really noticed this. It's been really interesting to look at compatibilities with all the normal techniques that I've taught, and then look at the real simple, easy to see human design connections, and to go, oh, aha, I get it. This is why these people never met, or when they met, it was more shallow than expected, or whatever. Okay. So again, it's another layer. If we only look at one layer, we're only going to predict that layer correctly. There's more than one layer to our experience. It starts with their energy potential, which is the human design, and it ends with the concrete manifestation, the actual concrete manifestation, which we could say is probably most well indicated in astrology by Jaimini principles. Okay? And then, you know, the Western or Tajika aspects, which are squares and oppositions and so on, those have to do so much with the concrete results too. Okay, that's why we use them in Varshafal, solar returns, and they just predict so well. They're very concrete. Yes, these two things are coming together for a moment in time to do this. Okay? And so what are you coming together in a moment in time to do with people? You can look at your Tajika aspects or Western style aspects. And then our Vedic astrology aspects, our planetary aspects, are really letting us see within ourselves, especially really what we're experiencing. And therefore, amongst two people, how are they really experiencing each other in a sense of a healthy or an unhealthy way? But if it's in a healthy way, what's the energy potential? How much power is there? Because just a healthy way is not enough. There has to be enough power to it to make it worthwhile. Because it's going to take a lot of time and energy to experience anything. So ultimately it has to go deep enough, which means there has to be the energy potential to go deep in. So it's really fascinating. I hope this little talk helps those of you all who have studied human design to kind of put it into perspective with other systems of astrology that you're studying, and to take advantage especially of the Lajitadi Avashtas and the maturation ages of the planets. Let's see, I talk about the maturation ages of the planets. I might have some videos somewhere on YouTube, I'm trying to remember. But I talk to about them a lot in a lot of my courses. They're in the Graha Sutras book for one. The Graha Sutras course. The Lajitadi Avashtas, I'm on my third class on those, because you can use those in so many ways. The current one I'm doing is Lajitadi Avashtas Master's course. And that course I'll do about how the habits or the planets in their Lajitadi Avashtas are causing us to have psychologically developed habits. And that these habits are either habits that further our life, which means help us live as ourselves, or planets that destroy our lives, in other words, live as the not-self. And if it's those kind of bad habits, how we can turn that bad habit into a good habit. Okay? And so each planet has a little different spiel on just what's going on and how to handle it. And Lajitadi Avashtas is really the most fascinating way, I think, of how planets are influencing planets on a very, very deeply meaningful level to our experience these days, where we really are in a psychological age where everything that's happening in our lives is an omen of our psychology, okay? Or a mirror, as we like to say, of our psychology. Okay, thank you.